Good morning and welcome to our Mothering Sunday service. It's lovely to be here and to welcome all you people out there that are joining us this morning. If there's any birthdays today, please message using our Facebook and we will try and include them when we have our celebrations towards the end of the service. So today is Mothering Sunday. It's the fourth Sunday of Lent, and it's traditionally a day when people return to visit their mother church or cathedral. Inevitably, the return to the mother church became a time when children who were working away, often in domestic service, returned home and visited their own mothers and family for the day. And so today we think of all those who are mothers, who are mothering and who care for children and older people. And we also remember that today may be a day of sorrow, especially in these poignant times of COVID, when so many people have not been able to see their mothers because of restrictions. And of course, so many of us have lost mothers during this time. But let us worship today as we begin. Come, now is the time to worship.
Now we're
And so we come before God just as we are to worship him today. We come today to thank God for mothers and carers around the world. It takes a special love to care for a family. Today we will celebrate that love and thank God for his own perfect love for us all. We are not all mothers ourselves, but we all have a mother, whether or not they are still with us, and we are all children of God. He is our loving Father. He is also the one who remembers and comforts us as a mother comforts her child and draws us close as a hen protects her chicks. And so let us pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you for mothers and carers everywhere, and for the special love they have for their children. We thank you, Jesus, for your special care and comfort, and the perfect love you have for us all. Help us all to show your love to those who care for us, and to the people that we meet in our lives. Amen. And so we're going to listen now, or sing, to the song, How Deep the Father's Love.
This I know with all my heart, his wounds that paid my ransom. Your wounds have paid my ransom.
So we are loved by God unconditionally. Let's come before him now to say sorry for the things that we've done that we're not proud of. There are things that happen which bring pain upon those who care for us, and sometimes we have been responsible for them. We say together, we seek God's forgiveness. There are things we have done that cause upset for those who care for us. We seek God's forgiveness. There are things we have done that cause despair for those who care for us. We seek God's forgiveness. There are times when we fail and cause sadness for those who care for us. We seek God's forgiveness. We're now going to have a time of quiet personal reflection when you can bring before God all those things which are heavy on your heart.
Laying yourself down.
So may God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, to forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we have our Gospel reading.
This is the word of the Lord. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there, and the disciples whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciples, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciples took her into his home. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning, everybody, and it's a great pleasure to be with you today on this Mothering Sunday. And I'm going to be preaching on the gospel reading we've just heard about Jesus on the cross and giving his mother in his final hours to his beloved disciple. And I'm going to be looking at the relationship between Jesus and Mary, looked at mainly through the eyes of Mary, his mother. But let me begin with a joke. I warn you that it's a joke so that you know to laugh. It goes like this. How do we know that Jesus was Jewish? Because his mother thought he was a god and he thought she was a virgin. Boom, boom. You're like, it's very good. But seriously, there's something special about the relationship between a mother and son. And the Gospels give us some amazing glimpses into the relationship between Jesus and Mary as mother and son. And what we find is that their relationship was just the same as our relationship with our mothers. They weren't any different. The way the Gospels are written, you only get the barest details. And you have to use your imagination to flesh out the story and get all the subtleties hidden between the lines. Mary had some wonderful times as Jesus' mother. But as any parent knows, the realities of being a mother are not all one way. There can be a lot of pain as well. And John, the Gospel writer, didn't pull his punches when he wrote up the story Well, today we've been offered a choice of gospel readings. The other reading was from Luke, when Mary and Mary and Joseph presented Jesus in the temple as a baby, and old Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the rising and falling of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed." Now get this, "And the sword will pierce your own soul too." What a mixture of things to say over a baby. Isn't it good when people say nice things about your baby and promise that they're going to grow up to be something special? I remember a gypsy lady saying that to my mother about me when I was about knee-high to a grasshopper. But Simeon also added the bit about the sword, and that was a bit spooky, wasn't it? It's something that Mary never forgot. The Bible says she pondered these things in her heart. And that invitation to ponder these things in your heart is extended to us as well. We are invited to ponder these things in our heart. And that's what I'm about today, is trying to unfold some of this story and some of this relationship so that you can ponder them in your hearts. Well, today I went with the second option of reading from John's Gospel, which is the one we just heard, where Jesus, speaking from the cross, gave his mother into the care of the disciple whom he loved. That's John. And that's always stayed in my mind as one of the most selfless acts in the whole story, that Jesus, in the depths of his agony, close to death, still had time and presence of mind to think about the welfare of his mother. The story of Mary and Jesus is so very human. It helps us to keep a perspective on Jesus. I think if we don't, there's a danger that we start to think of Jesus as perhaps some kind of Superman who wasn't really human at all. But these stories keep us rooted in the fact that actually, at heart, that Jesus was fully God, but also fully human. You know, there's something extraordinary, isn't there, in the relationship between with a mother's relationship with a child, which the father cannot share. The mother carried the child in her womb for 9 months, for one thing. If there is a dad listening who carried the child in his womb, please see me afterwards. I should love to hear your insights. Mary felt the life of the child inside her. And through great pain, as mothers do, she gave birth. And you don't forget something like that. As soon as Jesus was born, he was put in her arms. She nursed him, kept him alive, helped him to grow. And that's quite unique, isn't it? I always marvel that God would subject himself to being a helpless baby in the arms of a human mother, just like the rest of us. Later, the soldiers came to Bethlehem to massacre all the children, including Jesus. And imagine that, someone wants to kill your baby. Joseph was warned in a dream, and he got up in the middle of the night and he took Mary and Jesus and fled south, ending up in Egypt as a refugee. Imagine the terror of the Holy Family as they pushed on mile after mile through the night with a toddler in tow, desperately trying to get to the border before the soldiers caught up with them. Think then of the millions of refugees and displaced persons fleeing from war and death today. We often see this on our television screens. And how many mothers, like Mary, have been forced to grab what they can and flee in the middle of the night, trying to get to a place of safety. What will they live on? Where will they find work? Where will they live? What will happen to everything they've left behind? We don't know how the Holy Family got on in Egypt, except that they survived and they were able to return home after Herod died. But many refugees today finish up in refugee camps for years on end, and some try to get to Europe and drown in overcrowded boats. Mary knew about being a refugee. Jesus knows about being a refugee. Mothers look after their children and they do their best for them. They look forward to their children growing up and marrying and settling down and having a good job and a nice house and grandchildren they can help with. And Mary was no different. Just think of this. The Lord and creator of the entire universe was brought into this world by a human mother, was fed and weaned and raised by a human mother, was cared for, was comforted, was taught so much about life by a human mother. From Mary, Jesus would have learned the scriptures. From Mary, Jesus would have seen love in action. When Jesus grew up, so much of what he was would have come from Mary's example. Isn't that true of all mothers? Jesus was the result of the mixing of the Holy Spirit and a human being, not just when he was conceived, but as he was growing up too. They say, don't they, that the child's future is settled before they start school. All the building blocks in the forming of their mind has already happened by the time they start school. The role that mothers play in forming their children is so often underestimated. You know, my mother used to insist that she knew me better than I know myself. And I think actually that's probably true, because I think self-awareness and self-knowledge is something that comes with age. And I didn't know myself as a youngster. But as a mother, when you've lived with a child since the moment it was born, you quickly learn about the character and personality of your child. And we can see this, for example, at the wedding feast at Cana. Jesus brushes off requests to do something about the wine, saying his time has not yet come. But it was Mary who could see that he was wrong. Mary knew better than the Son of God, at least on this occasion. Mary and the other women in the Gospels weren't just onlookers, people in the background, but they were part of Jesus' ministry team, looking after the men, putting buttons back on their coats and feeding them and generally looking after them, as was the custom in those days. Although not often mentioned in the Gospel stories, Mary would have been there day by day during those 3 years of ministry. In the background, working away quietly, unnoticed. She would have seen the crowds wanting to make him king, and she would have heard the evil words of the leaders of Israel wanting to kill him. To kill Jesus, her little boy. Why? What had he done? He was only speaking the truth. But as we know, if you speak truth to power, you'll pay for it. You don't get away with that scot-free. And Mary would have heard. It's horrible for a parent when people have a go at your child. One of our children was bullied at school for a while and it hurts, and there's not much you can do about it. The school was fairly ineffective. And in the end, we moved her to another school. Mary didn't have that option. Jesus was set upon a course in his life and there was no choice but for Mary to follow him to his destiny. So finally, Jesus goes up to Jerusalem on Palm Sunday and Mary and the women would have been with him. How glad her heart would have been during the triumphal entry into Jerusalem with her blessed son riding on a donkey. At last, my son is getting the recognition he deserves. At last, it's all coming together. I always said Jesus is the Messiah. Now look, the crowds agree, and he's going to be crowned like his ancestor David. It all went wrong though, didn't it? By Thursday of Holy Week, Judas had betrayed him. He was arrested and tried on trumped-up charges. Pilate was arm-twisted into signing the death warrant. And on Friday morning, he is scourged and led away to die. There's a tradition that on the way to Calvary in the Via Dolorosa through Jerusalem, he stopped and met his mother in the crowd. How must Jesus have longed to be comforted by his mother at that point? How must she have longed to tenderly bathe his wounds and dress them? To take him home where he could get better? No more of this Messiah stuff. Let's just go home and live quietly. Jesus won't cause any more bother. But it was too late for that. There was no going back. Jesus must keep going right to the end of his mission. The soldiers dragged them apart and forced Jesus to carry his cross down and out of the city and across the valley and up to Golgotha, the place of the skull. Mary and the women follow with John. Everyone else has run away, but this small group follow on. Their love for Jesus is greater than any fear they have for themselves. And they witness as Jesus is stretched out and the nails are driven into his hands and feet, and how his mother felt the agony of each one as they were driven into, as if they were driven into her own flesh. "Let me die instead," she must have cried. But that was not possible. This was an ordeal for Jesus and Jesus alone. Hour after hour, she waited with Jesus as he grew weaker and weaker. But then he revives a little and says the famous words, "Son, behold your mother, and mother, behold your son." Even in his final moments, he is still thinking of his mother. Finally, with a loud cry, he gave up the ghost. When they take him down, tradition has it that they laid him in his mother's lap. With what sense of sorrow, deep sadness, and bewilderment did she gaze on his lifeless body? She goes with the women to bury him in a borrowed tomb. Of course, we know the story has a happy ending on Easter Day with the resurrection. But we haven't got there yet. Today, the gospel leaves us with a mother and son torn apart by cruel men and the tide of history. Treasure these things and ponder these things in your heart as we move toward Easter Sunday and the joy and triumph of the resurrection. Amen.
Thank you, Peter. It's good to remember that Jesus came amongst us as an ordinary child, as he grew into an ordinary man, and that he was mothered in the same way that we all are by his mother Mary. Jesus came to show us the way to God. So as we think about all the words that Peter has shared with us this morning, let us sing 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on saying. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Worship Your holy name. Bless You, Lord. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship.
She's led by Wendy.
The response to, as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord, is, may it be so for us. Amen. Lord, on this day which is set aside to honour and remember mothers, we give you thanks for our mothers. We are grateful that you chose to give us life through them, and that they received the gift of life from you and gave it to us. We thank you for the women who raised us, who were our mothers in childhood, whether birth mum, adopted mum, older sister, aunt, grandmother, stepmother, or someone else. We thank you for those women who held us and fed us, who cared for us and kissed away our pain. We pray that our lives may reflect the love they showed us, and that they will be pleased to be called our mums. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord. May it be so for us. Amen. We pray for anyone who needs the care of a mother, for anyone for whom this has been a hard day, for anyone who was suffering as a result of broken relationships, for anyone feeling lost, lonely, fragile, or afraid. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord. May it be so for us. Amen. We thank you for people who offer us the care of a mother, for their nurture and care, for the example and inspiration, for the love and friendship. We thank you, Lord, for the local schools and colleges and the staff who teach, care and look after our children. And we pray especially for Samson and the school in Kenya. And we pray also for First Steps Preschool, Dove, All Saints, Rycroft, JCB Academy, Abbott's Home and Denston College. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord. May it be so for us. Amen. We bring before you all those who are ill and suffering. Remember all families who are anxious about someone they love. We thank you for the skill of all those in the medical profession and all those working in the NHS. We pray for all those affected by COVID and pray for a time when we can combat this disease. And we pray today especially for those in our community who are sick. Pat Oakes, Pat Austin, Sheila Jackson, Victoria Dixon, June and Gordon Goodwin, Stephen Davis, Lindsay Smallwood, Margaret Sargent, Keith Burns, John McGurr, Ken Langton, Ina Randall, Sue Coxon, Mick and Yvonne Davis and the family, Stevie Warren, Baby Rudyard Jones, Phil Ellis, Neil Hutchinson. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord. May it be so for us. Amen. We remember all those who have died and commend them to your everlasting love. And we pray today especially for the family and friends mourning Gilbert Edgerton, Dorothy Stanier, Kenneth Burns, George Kent, Paul Lodge, Josephine Holland, and Les Umphris. We ask these prayers in the name of our loving God, Father, Mother, and Carer, who has given us the right to be called his children. Amen.
Amen.
We continue in prayer as we now say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And now we're going to sing again. In Christ alone, when all else fails, Christ is our strength. So let's sing.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my soul. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all and all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took a flash, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since Christ has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. And no power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. And no power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand.
So it's worth thinking about the words of that song. Here in the power of Christ we all stand. So whatever you're going to be doing this next week, today as we celebrate Mother's Day and as you go out, just hold on to those words, that here we stand in the power of Christ. And now we're going to look at some celebrations today. Well, it's Mothering Sunday, so there's lots of love going on out there. My technical support tells me, Gary over there, that there's lots of lovely messages going on, lots of mums who are loved today, so that's lovely. So love to all mums out there who are with us this morning. And to any that are not, we send our prayers and our love to them too. We've got some birthdays, or we've got a birthday. It's Pat Oakes' birthday. So happy birthday to you, Pat. I was trying to remember the happy birthday song, but it's completely gone out of my head, the one we sing at church. So happy birthday. We've got some wedding anniversaries too. Pat and Doug Oakes, it's their 61st wedding anniversary. Well, that really is some celebration. Well done to Pat and Doug Oakes. Well done. I'm assuming you've got lots of celebrations, Pat, a birthday and an anniversary. So, well done. 61 years is definitely something to celebrate. And we've also got the first anniversary of Paulette and Cavill Portman, who were married at Denston 12 months ago. So it's their first wedding anniversary today. So let's just pray for both those couples. We ask that the Lord continues to bless Pat and Doug and Paulette and Cavill in their marriages, and that through the joys and sorrows of life they can come before the Lord and know his presence and his love in their lives. Amen. We also celebrate today the baptism of Stanley Morley, which was on the 15th of March 2020. Stanley was baptised, so we remember that today. And we also just pray for Stanley. So that we pray that the Lord will bless and keep Stanley and his family, and that we'll keep him in his loving care. Amen. I don't think there are any other, Gary, no. But if there are any celebrations that we've missed, we do bless them and hold them up to the Lord. So now our final prayer. Loving God, we thank you for mums and children and for all the joy of family life. Be with those who are grieving because they have no mother. Be close to those who are struggling because they have no children. Be near to those who are sad because they are far apart from those they love. Let your love be present in every home and help your church to have eyes to see and ears to hear the needs of all who come. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We've got some notices now to get things that are going on in church. Let's see what they are. Hopefully they're going to come up right. We've got a Zoom every Thursday, 7:30 till 9, and it's going through the Lenten. We're looking at the Lenten characters at the crucifixion. Gary's leading that. It's on Judas this week, so that should be an interesting session. Judas. So if you'd like to join and you're not on the email list, if you let Gary or Liz know, they'll help you to join. Now then, this is about food that's been donated. Matthew 25, when I was hungry, you fed me. If there's anybody in the village that's got some things to donate, food can be left at the Premier store, the spa shop and outside the vicarage. I think that everything else is pretty self-explanatory there. Okay? If you'd like to make a monetary donation towards the church, then you can do so through the Lichfield Diocese website. The link is there. Thank you. And so those are our notices for this week, and it's the fourth Sunday of Lent today. Oh, there's one more. The youth group. I know that the youth group are out this morning delivering plants around the village. So keep the youth group in your prayers. These are difficult times for us all, but especially for the young people. And I know they've been doing great things on Zoom. We've got a great group of young and older people in the youth group, but do keep them in your prayers. Are they doing anything else, Gary, or have I covered it all there? We've covered it all there. Okay. Well, could I just, before we carry on, just thank our technical support here. We've got Gary and Ian over here. And thank Peter for his word this morning. And also Adam and Wendy for their contribution to the service. I can't say it's been great to see you because I can't see you, but it's been great to have you with us. We are going to now have a hymn before the final blessing. How great is our God? And he certainly is. How great is our God?
Age to age, he stands.
to sing with me, How Great Is Our God. And so our final blessing. Let us go from here rejoicing that God loves us and welcomes us with open arms. As the children of God, we take his love into the world, that others may also rejoice and be part of his family. Amen.